So, hi guys, this is Dr. Edwards again, and I want to make some additional comments on differential equations. And I'm taking this set of informations from your Mathematical Methods book for physicists of Weber and Ofkin. So I'm going to spend my time on first order differential equations, having already given you a brief introduction on higher order differential equation, particularly the second order. Okay, so let me get started here. In my opinion, there is nothing so overly difficult about differential equations in the first place, particularly these linear differential equations. And what I mean by linear, if you talk about differentiating one dependent variable with respect to an independent variable. If you have two of them, you can add them, and then it's the differential of the sum of the two. You see, where a and b here are constant. That's just a valid feature about linear physics in the beginning with linear mathematics. Often you can think of the differential equation written in some operator form. L operate on psi and gives you the value f. That's the way you can think about this, where L is going to be some set of differentials. Let me go on. Now, let me say one thing here. If the f in the previous equation is equal to zero, we say that it is a homogeneous differential equation if f is zero. If f does not equal zero, we call it an inhomogeneous differential equation. And so when f is zero, you solve the equation and you get one solution. You then go on and you find the particular solution when f does not equal to zero, and the sum of those become the general solution to that particular differential equation. Now, this is the standard form of the first order differential equation. Regardless of what the variables are, here we are saying simply that y is a dependent variable on x. Yeah, y is the dependent variable, x is the independent variable, and this differential may be a function of both x and y. That's all that means. And oftentimes, in certain way of writing the differential equation, it is advantageous to write it in this quotient way, that f of x of y is equal to negative capital P of x y over q of x y. And that's because then you can come here, you write it this way. And now it looks like you can separate. Then if you have the special case, and you're always looking for special cases with these first order differential equations. If for some problems p is only a function of x and y is only a function of q is only a function of y, excuse me, then you get this equation. And what's special about this equation is that the variables are separated. The first term here is a function of just x. The second term here is just a function of y. You can directly integrate both sides of this equation. You integrate the x part from some, this is an indefinite integral, you can do it that way. You integrate the x part with respect to x, and you integrate the y part. The variables are separated, and you can integrate that directly. Let's consider this example that occurs from radioactive decay processes in physics. And you can immediately see that You can separate variables here, and when you can separate variables, you have in principle the way of solving that differential equation, first order. So that's the first thing you look for when I give you problems of first order. You endeavor to see if the variables can be separated. And when they are separable, then you can integrate the equation, one variable aspect, the other variable aspect, and you can move on towards getting the solution. All right, so in this example, 8.2.1, the decay of a radioactive sample involves an event that is repeated at a constant rate, lambda. If the observation time dt is small enough so that the emission of two or more particles is negligible, then the probability that one particle is emitted is lambda dt. And if that is the case, then you get this as the differential equation, that the rate of change of n of t with time is related to n of t. And lambda is just some constant, of course, negative lambda is a constant. So therefore, you have right away that you can, so the two variables here are n, which is a function of time, and t, time. So you can separate variables. That's what the author does here. He separates variables. So dn over n on the left-hand side and negative lambda dt on the right-hand side. Voila, you can integrate this. And the integral of dn over n is e to the n plus some constant of integration that he calls n sub zero here. And the integral of lambda dt is just lambda t. So therefore, you have the general solution right there. And now you can go on and solve this equation. If you have some specific conditions at t equals zero, then you have a specific differential equation. Let me go on. Another example here is the parachutist. And this is unrealistic because the parachute opens as soon as the parachutist leaves the aircraft. But this is the differential equation to be solved. MdV is equal to mg minus bv squared, where m is the mass, g is the acceleration due to gravity, and b is a constant, which is going to be related to the friction or drag on the parachute. So you go on and you solve this equation here. You get the equation in standard form, and voila, once again, the variables can separate between v and t. So you can integrate this equation here. You go on to integrate, and you go on, and you finally, after doing some algebraic manipulations, you get the solution v equals v sub zero, the hyperbolic tan of lowercase t, the variable, over capital T, which is a constant. Capital T has been defined here someplace. Where is capital T? Oh, capital T is the square root of the mass over the acceleration due to gravity times b, the drag constant. Let me go on. Now, okay, so let's come to the situation that you have this form of the differential equation once again, where now p is a function of both x and y, and q is a function of both x and y, and they're equal to zero. We ask the question, can you write this as an exact differential of two variables, and you write it in terms of phi. So d phi is equal to the partial of phi with respect to x dx plus the partial of phi with respect to y dy. If this is true, then it must be the case that p of x dx in this manner is related in this manner. Therefore, these two terms are equal. And therefore, you can find a solution provided that the mixed differential is also equal. And this becomes the solution to that particular differential equation. Okay, let me go on. So I'll make sure I give you a problem of this kind. Now, here's another situation. Suppose that the equation is not exactly separable. You can find what's called an integrating factor. And here is what we call some alpha as a function of x and t. And if you multiply that times the differential equation, you can then find, then you can separate the variables and you can proceed with an integration. Let me give you one other special case now. Go back to equation 8.2, and suppose that the variable that the function f of x, y is written in this manner, and it will often be that way. Therefore, then you get this form of the first order differential equation. Dy dx is related to some variable as a function of x times y, and some function of x on this side of the equation. You get this equation here quite a bit in electricity and magnetism for RC circuits and for LC circuits that's driven by some voltage. All right. Now he asked the question. Suppose Q of x is zero. If that's the case, you can immediately separate variables and you can integrate. Okay? So you're always looking to see if you can separate variables, as I said earlier about the first order partial differential equation. If Q of x is not zero, then you have to find an integrating factor. But I tell you can pretty much always find an integrating factor for this problem. And so what he does, he multiplies the integrating factor, whatever it is, we don't know what it is yet. And when he does that, the equation takes this specific form. And you see, you can integrate the left-hand side of this equation, and you can integrate the right-hand side of this equation. And when you do that, you get an equation for the integrating factor. D alpha dx is equal to something that's a function of just x. Therefore, you can integrate this equation. You do so and find the integrating factor, which can be done, blah, blah, blah. And then once you get the integrating factor, then you can go back and find the dependent variable as 1 over the integrating factor times the integration of the integrating factor times the right-hand side quantity Q plus the constant of integration C. Let me show you this example where he does that here, and then I'll let you go. He does it right here. And this is a problem from electricity and magnetism. You consider this a simple series circuit. There's a voltage source here, an inductor, and a resistor. So one will get this equation here. What is the current as a function of time? Is equal to the inductance times di dt plus the resistance time I as a function of t and the voltage source. Now this looks a lot like the equation that I told you about earlier. Let me go back there and show it to you. Looks a lot like that right here. There it is there. The variables are just different, but that's no big deal. Okay? So now you get this equation in this standard form by dividing every term by L to get one in front of the first differential. So this become R over L. So R over L now, this is the way you find the integrating factor. The integrating factor is the exponential of the integral of R over L, which is the term before I. You integrate that and you get that the integrating factor is e to the rt over l. What I should have said, r is known, l is known, r is known. So the only thing that's unknown here is capital I, and you want to find it as a function of time. So you go through the process here. Then if you have the value for v, you can perform the integration. And then you finally get the answer you want. Okay, that's what I wanted to share with you guys. Go and work on the homework problems. Have a good day.